encumbered with anything, just very natural. And, you know, I mean, that would be my explanation. I think it's the best representation of his universe.
It was obviously very similar, but I certainly didn't feel that it was good. It was, I mean, when somebody's made their ultimate statement, not that I necessarily knew that Trout Mask was his ultimate statement at the time, but it was obviously a major work for good or bad. What follows is always going to have some difficulties, you know. I mean, doesn't have to be as weird as Trout Mask Replica. I mean, just look at exactly the same time. Look at the difficulty Pete Townsend had following up Tommy. You know, you've made the very fact that it was a double album implies that it's some kind of major statement. What do you do next? Where do you go next? Do you do something completely different, or do you do more of the same? And either way, you're almost on a hiding to nothing. I mean, what struck me, I think, about Lick My Decals was it seemed to be more engaged lyrically with the real world. You know, I mean, some of his sort of environmental concerns and so on come through very strongly on that album. But I think it just suffered. I know some people do say it's their favourite Beefheart album, but to me, it did slightly suffer from the wow, how do you follow that syndrome.
Although both Trout Mask and Lick My Decals Off, Baby had been largely dismissed by American audiences, in Europe, Beefheart and his magic band were a more viable commercial entity. In Britain, in particular, through the support of DJ John Peel, the band's ambition was widely recognised, and both of these difficult albums charted in the UK top 30.
With both those records, I found that the more I listened to them, the more I sort of got into it. You know, there are things that you noticed after you played it about 60 times. And, you know, at first something like that seems inaccessible. But, you know, for some reason, if the mood is right in a certain sort of light, in a certain atmosphere, something like that, it reaches out and holds you forever. And, you know, I think that it actually enabled people to have a more sort of open mind about difficult music.
Some of the songs, you have to listen to them a number of times before you really hear what's going on there, because at first you hear a lot of, you know, you don't get it at first. And you have to listen to it, and there's those, I think the mentality of the British and the Europeans are such that they pick up on this stuff a little easier than the Americans for some reason. I don't know whether it is, if it's a rebellious kind of thing that they lock into this.
It was a civilization that understood hard work, they understood art, and they recognized something that was a lot deeper and a lot more important than just meat market music to sell albums and to get butts in a stadium seat, you know. So I wasn't really surprised that the music did better in Europe than it did here.
Essentially, there was no way that anybody who was working on those kind of outer edges, like Beefheart was, for him to achieve any kind of commercial profile in America. And it's a hard slog from that point forward for anybody. You know, there are profound sociological reasons why punk and new wave music did not retain any serious stranglehold on the American psyche, or at least didn't until much, much later than in the UK. And the examples that you use of Trout Mask Replica and Lick My Decals being successful commercial albums, you can find another 20 examples. Marquee Moon was a top 10 album in the UK. It didn't make the top 100 in America. And it's an American album with a completely American sensibility. Ditto for Trout Mask Replica, certainly. There simply is an on pass that American popular tastes reach. And it is impossible to understand the course of rock music until that is accepted.
This impasse was something that Van Vliet was very conscious of, To follow up Lick My Decals Off Baby, the band returned to their blues roots, and the result, the Spotlight Kid, was both more accessible and more conventional.
I don't think he ever lost his love of the blues throughout his career, and it certainly comes through very much so on the opening track of Spotlight Kid, I'm Gonna Booglerize Your Baby.
I'm gonna booglerize your baby.
The music was based on more orthodox chord structures. You know, there's even a sort of 12-bar blues in there somewhere.
Come on over to my house, and I'll see you.
I think Don's business people, like Grant Gibbs, Mark Green, and Al Leifer, had gotten together with Don and sat down and said, Don, you've got to do slower music. You've got to do simpler stuff. You're not getting through to the people. You're not making any money. You know. So he started listening to the business people and decided to do the Spotlight Kid.
Spotlight Kid's a lot simpler. In fact, Don said that he did it for the musicians, and then when it was criticised, he said, well, they let me down, they didn't play very well on it, which I thought was somewhat unfair. But it is, something about it is it's so ponderous. It's very, it's got a drab production sound. It really just lumbers along. If you get the feeling if the tracks are all about half as fast again, it would add a bit more energy. There seems to be something laboured about it. And whereas some of the songs on it are very good and some of the playing good, it's got a kind of drabness to it, which after something like Lick My Decals Off, which was had such a huge energy to it, it's slightly disappointing.
When I listen to Spotlight Kid now, I can appreciate it. But at the time, I hated that album. I hated it. Because for one thing, it was boring to play. A lot of that stuff was really boring to play. Because it was so simple, and so it wasn't going anywhere. For another thing, a lot of the tracks were just so slow. Like, All You Ever Do Is Blabber and Smoke, which was the same thing as, the same riff as Grow Fins, you know. So, you know, there's two tracks on there that are basically the same song with just a couple of different breaks in it. We hated it. You know, we just hated it.
For the instrumental track Alice in Blunderland, Van Vliet chose to utilize erstwhile Magic Band member Elliot Ingber to add lead guitar, a component rarely featured in the band's previous output.